Welcome to Valley Forge Baptist Temple. Good to have each one out today. We've had a great weekend. We had 130 or 40 out for Community Blitz yesterday. Many of you are getting community connections in your mail. And so this is the time. This is our preparation for our Super Bowl with Easter Sunday next week. And we want to be able to shine the good news and the light of Jesus Christ that He is risen. He is a wonderful and faithful God, as our choir sang. And so we're going to pray today as we pray through Psalm 147, the second half of it. So join me as we pray together and ask God to meet with us and bless us today. May we join together in prayer. Our Father, we come to You this morning with the psalmist, knowing that You are pleased with those who fear You and love You. You give mercy to those who put their trust in You. Just as You have blessed Israel in the past, so You have blessed us in the present. Thank You for the many, many blessings of peace and prosperity You have brought to our land. You have sent Your commandments to all the earth through Your word. Now, Lord, help us to learn those commandments, to love them, and to obey them. You send snow and frost and hail upon the earth, and then You send Your command, and it all melts, and we enjoy spring once again, even as we see today. As You open the message of Your word to the Jews in the past, would You do so to us, Your children, on this Lord's day, even as we remember Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, fulfilling Your promises. Teach us to claim those promises today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you're visiting for the first time, we're so glad to have you here. If you would raise your hand for a moment, we'd like to pass one of the welcome booklets to you. There's a connection card attached to it. You can fill that out, drop that in the offering plate in just a few moments.
To see the dawn of the darkest day. Thank you, choir, for that. Would you stand and let's continue to sing about that power. All hail the power of Jesus' name. 531 in your hymn books. We'll sing the first, the third, and the last this morning. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrest fall. All majesty and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord. Let's lift our voices as we sing the last verse. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng. Let's sing it out. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his may fall. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown. This morning, take a moment, greet someone before we continue. As you find your seats, we'll continue to sing in just a moment. If you have not received a copy of the notes for Pastor's message, raise your hand at this time. The ushers will make sure to get that to you for a little bit later in the service. Sing with me now, 365, How Great Thou Art. We'll sing just the first and the last as we continue.
Oh, Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration.
Amen. Great singing this morning. Please be seated.
At any time, a church family like ours, some are going through deep valleys and sorrows, and some are going through wonderful mountaintop joys. And so we say that a shared sorrow is half a sorrow, and a shared joy is a double joy. We ask you to continue to pray for the Zinchenko family. Elena is very close to heaven, and so I know the angels are attending, but as you intercede for that family, that would be a tremendous blessing to them. And also, God has blessed our church family with a new baby. I'm going to ask James Schneider to come at this time. We'd like to present a rose to to present to Bethany. And so we rejoice that God has blessed James and Bethany with a new one. And a new baby in the church also means a new grandbaby for four folks in our church. Come on in here, James. Congratulations. Tell us about your other kids first.
We have two. We have Carly. She's 3 1/2. And Andrew, who's about 2 1/2.
And who do you have with you here today?
This is Brody.
Hey, Brody.
It's Broderick William, but we'll call him Brody. And he was born on May 27th. He was, March 27th. Excuse me.
It's all right. Sorry. March 27th.
March 27th at 6:24 a.m.
Did he keep you up all night?
He did, yeah.
Yeah. Did you get any rest? Did you get to doze at all or not?
Not really.
No?
Just too much excitement, I guess.
Yeah. Good. And how much did he weigh?
He was 8 pounds and 12 ounces.
Good.
And 22 inches long.
Good. And I know you've had some medical testing, so right now things are going well as far as you know.
As far as we know so far,
yeah. Good. We'll continue to pray for you about that. And glad to have Bethany out today. She's doing better. So please present this to your lovely wife. Congratulations to you. Congratulations to grandparents as well. So let's rejoice with them today. That's a handful. Balancing two there. He's got experience at it, though. What a joy to have both sets of grandparents in the church for these grandkids as they grow up. Be able to see mom and dad, grandmas and grandpas and church family loving and serving the Lord. Our ushers are going to come at this time. We'll receive our tithes and offerings for today. As we have Community Blitz, which we do 3 times a year, we want to highlight in our Community Connection card other ways for you to be involved in visitation. So if you take a look at that, many things listed there on the Connection card. One is the child care for the missionary conference, if you'd like to help out with that, and the times are listed there. We have times where we're teaching the missionaries, where the missionaries are ministering, and then we take them to Sight and Sound. This year it's going to be on Saturday. So lots of opportunities to help them out. But as far as the community outreach, we have our visitation, and we're now doing that. It is organized, but it is organized through email. So if you'd like to be able to help with that, you check that off, give us your name, address, and email, and so you can do follow-up that way, as many others do. Extra Mile Project is an opportunity for mostly for our ladies, but some men as well. Go to the Outreach Center closet, and you get a box of cards, and you then, in turn, can encourage those who are going through times of trial and being able to write a note to them, and then occasional outreach events, community days, First Fridays, those kinds of things. Jerusalem Project is new move-in visits. Again, you go to the closet, self-serve, get some addresses, get a gift bag. You're the Christian welcome wagon. And so this is how you learn about that, by signing up that way. And then, of course, if you want offering envelopes, Connections is to get to know more about us for those who are visiting, those who are new to the church, and we'll meet together April 30 for time down in the Common Ground Cafe. So those are some things listed there for you to be aware of. I'd like to ask for the Lord to ask a blessing upon our offering today.
Father, we are so thankful that, Father, that you've given us the opportunity to come here today to worship you, Father. And Lord, we pray for those who are home, Lord, that can't be here because of sickness or illness, Lord. And Lord, we think of the Chancellor family today, Lord, and the trial that they're going through. Father, we just ask that thy hand be upon them, that you would give them the grace that they need, Father, for this trial. Lord, just ask for that, Father. Help us, Father, to continue to pray for them, Lord. Father, we just pray that as we go into this week, Father, and everybody's thinking of Easter, pray, Lord, that we would be mindful, Lord, to be able to give and share the gospel. Father, to give hope. Father, to be able to tell others, Father, that Christ is not dead, but he has rose. And that, Father, I pray as we see the flowers begin to blossom, the buds on the trees begin to bloom, Lord, remind us, Father, that we have new life, Father, through the Christ and through the precious blood of Christ, Lord. Help us to be mindful, Father, to be ready and willing, Father, to share the gospel with whoever you put in our path. Empower, Pastor, with thy word, Father. Help us, Lord, to not be hearers, but to be doers. Father, help us, Father, to be ready to give an account for what we've done, Father, here on earth. Be with this offering, Lord. Use it as you see fit, Father, I pray in thy name. Amen.
Just for love of me, Jesus, God's most precious treasure.
Thank you, ladies, for the beautiful song today. No question, God loves you. He loves me. He proved that on the cross. Would you please open your Bibles today to Ephesians 3 this morning, Ephesians chapter 3. There are two prayers found in the book of Ephesians. The first one was in chapter 1, where Paul prayed for enlightenment and understanding of the wonderful riches given to us the moment we received Jesus Christ as our Savior. Here is the second prayer. You see them contrasted there in your notes. The prayer for enablement, the prayer for empowerment. The first prayer is of God's deposit and then our withdrawal. Here he tells us, know your power, and this prayer is use your power. And this passage may help all of us to pray just a little bit different as we understand this passage a little bit better. Please stand with me as I read from Ephesians chapter 3. And beginning in verse 14. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. May we pray. Father, I ask that you might fulfill these prayer requests in our lives, that we would be filled with you, that the life and love of Jesus Christ might overflow from our hearts, strengthen us in the inner man, that we might be all that you'd have us to be. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We are filled with God's love. Can you believe there was a day when I did my own car repairs? When I was a college student, my dad sold me his 1972 two-door Duster. Now, this isn't it, all right? But mine looked close to this. It couldn't go near as fast as this old Duster. Back then, I did all the repairs on my car. I mean, not just changing the oil, but I changed the brakes. I replaced the spark plugs. I even put in a new starter. Right now, Joe Jeffries from Last Chance Auto and John Bilbo are in shock how in the world could Pastor Wendal do all that work on the car? Well, it was because my dad was leaning over my shoulder, and he would tell me exactly what to do. And if I made a mistake, he told me that too, and I could learn how to be able to do that. But now there are computers in cars. The days of the backyard mechanic are over, but we still have a few men in our church who know cars so well that they can even pull out an engine and replace it with a new one. It is possible to know a whole lot about a car, but yet never go anywhere. It is also possible to know very little about a car and use it every day to travel hundreds of miles. Today, I don't know anything about how to fix a car, but you know, I drive one every day. And the same is true about the Bible, as you see in your notes, about the Bible and you. You can know a great deal about the Bible, its doctrines, its moral teachings, its promises, its warnings. You can know about it and yet not live by those truths. But how important to take what you do know and live it out every day. I mean, that's really living. And this is what Paul wants for the Ephesians here in chapter 3. Paul has taught them about their riches in Christ from chapter 1 all the way through 3:13. And now he is urging them to live out God's truth for it to be real and authentic in their lives. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus taught us to pray for both our spiritual needs and our physical needs. Give us this day our daily bread. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. You see the physical, you see the spiritual. Though it is important to pray for our body, it is infinitely more significant to pray for our soul. And the Bible instructs us to pray for one another when we are sick, James chapter 5. Yet as we see in this chapter, the prayer for our soul, our heart, our inner man is what God is most concerned about. You can go to the church website and listen to the message from Wednesday night comparing inner man and outer man. Look how Paul introduces his prayer here in verse 14. For this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we pray to the Father. Jesus taught us to pray to the Father, Matthew 6:9. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven. We do not come to God in fear. We come to God as our heavenly Father. We do not come to God to appease his wrath the way most of the world does with their false gods. The false gods are mad at people, and they come to appease him. But we come to a tender, loving, caring, and compassionate heavenly Father. What a difference between our God and their false gods. We also pray to God the Father. I bow my knees unto the Father. Paul says, when I pray for you, I do it on bended knee. I bow my knees in prayer for you. Now, the Bible does not command a special posture for prayer. And so when you go to the Bible, you'll find all different kinds of positions that men and women took in praying. And so we find Abraham, he stood before the Lord, and Solomon stood before the Lord when they prayed. And the Bible says that David, he actually sat before the Lord in the temple. We know that Hannah came in, and she had her head bowed, and she was praying. Her lips were moving, but it was a prayer of her heart, and there was no audible voice. And then the Bible says about Jesus that he fell on his face there in the Garden of Gethsemane. We don't have to bow our knees every time we pray. But in the Bible, bowing your knees in prayer signifies two things. First of all, an attitude of submission. In Paul's day, when someone approached royalty on the throne, you bowed the knee. God is our Father, but he is also our God. Now, you don't have to close your eyes when you pray, but I think it is a good practice for public worship. Now, I like to pray when I'm alone in the car. Keep your eyes open, all right? We all would appreciate it. If you pray when you're in the car, keep your eyes open. But when you close your eyes, you're stopping everything else, aren't you? When you close your eyes in prayer, you're not walking. You're not on your phone. You're not multitasking. You're singularly focused should be on praying to God when you close your eyes. Teach your kids to close their eyes for public prayer, for family prayer. It is a good thing. But also teach them to pray with their eyes open. Teach them to be praying all day long. May they hear you praying. May they not just hear Lord and God as exclamations of surprise, but may they hear it as prayer throughout the day. You're talking to God. So you can pray with your eyes open. You can pray with your eyes closed. You can pray standing, sitting. You can pray kneeling. An attitude of submission, Paul is kneeling. Secondly, intense and emotional times. We get on our knees in intense and emotional times. In the Bible, we see people bowing out of sincerity in special times of need, like Ezra, Daniel, Paul. Daniel knew the writing was signed, which was his death warrant, and yet he went to his house, his windows being opened in his chamber toward Jerusalem. He kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he did aforetime, knowing that it was going to be his death sentence. But God spared him. When the Apostle John saw the resurrected Lord in heaven in Revelation 1:17, and when I saw him in all of his glory, I fell at his feet as dead. To see Jesus in all of his glory was so overpowering that John had no strength and he collapsed. Pastor Joyner shared, as we began our community blitz yesterday, a testimony of a man who called the church, and the secretary set up the appointment, and he came in and shared the gospel with him. And at one point, the man just exclaimed, I just know I'm lost. Sharing the gospel, they got on their knees, and this man asked Jesus Christ to be a savior. That was on Friday, I believe. That's that attitude of submission. That's that intense and emotional time coming to Christ, interceding for others. Notice verse 15 now as he introduces his prayer, of whom the whole family, God the Father, in heaven and earth is named. This is not a verse to prove that everyone goes to heaven. Liberal, unbelieving pastors will refer to the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. They will wrongly conclude and teach that everyone goes to heaven. That is not true. There are 2 spiritual families with 2 spiritual fathers. God is the father of believers. John 8:42, if God were your father, you would believe in me, Jesus. Satan is the father of unbelievers. John 8:44, ye Pharisees are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. So every family in heaven and earth, that phrase refers to the saints of every age. Those who are believers now in heaven, those who are believers, those of us saved here on earth. Only believers can rightly claim God as their father. Now let me share the 3 prayers found here in Ephesians chapter 3. The first prayer is, Lord, I ask you to fill me with your strength. Dear Father, I pray because of the riches of your grace that you would help me to be strong by the might of your spirit in my inner man. We see that in verse 16, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. Now, what is the inner man? We were reminded Wednesday that the inner man is the immaterial, spiritual part of our being. The Bible often refers to our inner man with the words heart or mind or soul or spirit. The outer man refers to the body. Even though our body can grow old, our body will get sick and become weak and eventually die. All through our life, the inner man can be stronger and stronger. How? Be in the Word of God. I mean, just read it and memorize it and sing it and meditate upon it and believe it and hear it preached and taught and obey it. Be in God's house. I mean, don't just come, but come to worship and come to serve and come to be changed and come to minister to others. Come to be a blessing. And then thirdly, to pray. Lord, I am asking you for spiritual strength. To fill me with your strength. You need it. You need it. I need it. Let me illustrate it. One of the earlier U.S. nuclear submarines was called the Thresher. It had heavy steel bulkheads and steel armor, so it could dive deep and withstand the pressure of the ocean. Unfortunately, on a test run on April 10, 1963, a piping failure allowed salt water to shut down the nuclear reactor. It couldn't get back to the surface. The Thresher sank deeper and deeper into the ocean, where the pressure became immense. The heavy steel bulkheads buckled, and the Thresher was crushed with 129 people inside. It is the highest death toll of any submarine disaster to this day. President Kennedy ordered flags to be lowered to half-mast for 3 days. In searching for the Thresher, the Navy lowered a research craft shaped like a steel ball into the ocean on a cable 1.5 miles deep, much stronger than the sub. They found the Thresher, and it was crushed like an eggshell, which didn't surprise anybody because the pressure at that depth is tremendous. 3,600 pounds per square inch. That's a lot of pressure on the outside. What did surprise the researchers was the fish they saw at that great depth. Down there, the fish didn't have inches of steel to protect them. They appeared to have normal skin, a fraction of an inch thick. How then could they survive all of that pressure? How could they not be crushed by the weight of the water? It's because they have the same pressure inside themselves as there is on the outside. The water pressure inside keeps them from being crushed by the water pressure on the outside. Only a magnificent creator could have designed them to be this way. Yet another proof that evolution is a lie. Now here's the lesson. In the same way, we don't have to be hard. We don't have to be thick-skinned. We don't have to be calloused. We can be filled with God's power on the inside, in the inner man, equal to the pressure on the outside. The Bible says it this way: greater is he, God, that is in you than he, Satan, that is in the world, 1 John 4:4. That means we can defeat Satan's efforts and his attacks and his plans and his traps to trick and destroy us, because there is a power on the inside greater than the enemy's power on the outside. By God's Spirit, we can have the strength within to overcome the devil's maneuvers. All we need to do is ask and pray for this strength. Look what 1800s Pastor Philip Brooks wrote. Do not pray for easy lives. Pray to be stronger people. Do not pray for tasks equal to your powers. Pray for powers equal to your tasks. Then the doing of your work shall be no miracle, but you shall be a miracle. Every day you shall wonder at the richness of life which has come to you by the grace of God. Isn't that what happened to Paul? I mean, Paul's got this trial, and we're not sure exactly what it was. It's a thorn in the flesh. Three times he prays, God, God, would you take away the thorn? God, would you take away the thorn? God, would you take away the thorn? And God responds back, keep the thorn. Keep the trial. My grace is sufficient for you. And so in the prayer for power, what we see here is, Lord, I ask you to fill me with your strength, and so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And we will be amazed. We will experience his power and his grace as we invite him to do so. The second prayer is, Lord, I ask you to fill me with your love. I ask you to fill me with your love. Verse 17. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. Paul gives three verbs to help us understand how to be filled with God's love. The first one is dwell. Dwell in your hearts by faith. Now, this is a prayer that Christ may settle down and feel at home in your heart. The word implies taking possession of a home or a dwelling. In fact, the word is used to describe demon possession. Have you ever had someone stay in your guest room, maybe for an extended time, and you say, make yourself at home? If you really mean it, that person can rearrange the furniture. They could paint the walls. They can eat all your food. When someone truly makes themselves at home, they live in that home like they own the place. And well, that's what we want Christ to do in our hearts. As believers, we already know that Jesus Christ lives inside of us. But this is a prayer to feel at home in our hearts. We want him to live there like he owns the place. We want him to take possession of our hearts and to become the controlling influence in our attitudes and in our actions. There is a difference between just knowing about Christ and actually knowing Christ and having a personal relationship with him. And so I've asked one of our teenagers, Anthony Lopez, he's going to come and he's going to share a dramatic reading about this difference of knowing about Christ and actually knowing him. Anthony.
I am constantly amazed at how many people consider themselves to be Christians because they live by the Ten Commandments. Live by the Ten Commandments? Most people don't even know the Ten Commandments. The story, A Sinner's Day in Court, written in 1964 by Lewis Paul Layman, shows how every one of us is guilty of breaking the law of God. I remember the day I was subpoenaed to appear in court and give evidence why I should not be judged, condemned, and sentenced to eternal death for my treason against the law of God. There must be some mistake. I live by the Ten Commandments. I can get character references. I was hustled along until I found myself standing in an imposing chamber where hundreds of spectators sat within towering marble walls. The jury had been selected. I stepped back as I recognized some of its members. There in shining white sat the holiness of God. Next to him, in the robes of a scholar, was the wisdom of God. Dark robes signified the justice of God. And finally, robed in time, space, and eternity, sat the omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence of God. If ever a trial was to be rightful, it would be here, with this jury. Suddenly the clerk cried, "The judge of the quick and the dead!" And in one massive movement, everyone rose. Instinctively, I stood with them, and when the angels began singing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty," against my will, I found myself mouthing the words. The judge made his way to his place. The crowd settled back, and a tense stillness settled over the room. Anthony Jacob Lopez called the trial. The prosecuting attorney stood, and with smug assurance began, "We will now prove that Anthony Jacob Lopez, tried by the law of God, has violated every one of the Ten Commandments." "Why, sir, that isn't so. I have lived by the Ten Commandments." "Well," said the judge, not unkindly, "we shall have a chance to see whether or not this is true. Would you like to have counsel?" "Oh, no, I won't need counsel. I will represent myself. However, I would respectfully request, sir, that I be tried by grace, not by law. After all, I live in a day of grace."
"Oh," he paused. "So you want to be tried by grace? Have you been saved by grace?"
"Saved by grace? No, Your Honor, I want to be tried by grace."
"That is impossible. You can be saved by grace, but you can only be tried by law. Call your first witness."
The first witness came forward and was identified as the first commandment.
"Thou shalt have no other gods before me."
"Your Honor, I am not a heathen. I don't have a bunch of idols sitting around my house."
Suddenly, a mighty voice filled the hall. "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength."
Tell me, Mr. Lopez, have you always loved God? Your Honor, Anthony Jacob Lopez has put his own interests ahead of God. He may not have bowed down before idols, but he has worshipped many things before God. He gestured to the table where, for the first time, I saw a stack of my very own belongings. We asked the court's permission to enter the following materials evidence. I cringed as I noticed my prized DVD collection and latest video games. Your Honor, we have ample evidence that shows by texts, emails, his calendar, Facebook, Instagram. How did he get my phone or my security code? And other social media, the obvious lack of time spent in godly pursuits. Furthermore, these bank records, credit card statements, 1040s, W-2s, and tithed records are all clearly indicative of a violation of the first commandment. Guilty. The crack of the judge's gavel resonated throughout the courtroom. Suddenly, the second witness was sworn in. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. So I jumped up. Your Honor, I have already made it clear that I have no idols to which I bow. No? And what about that sports car you wanted? I never had a sports car. But you made it a god, didn't you? You don't have to have something to worship it. Guilty. Once again, the judge's gavel cracked. I was soon found guilty of violating the third commandment. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Who could argue when he pointed out that vain meant empty, and then, with a click, brought up videos showing the many times I had called on God, praying empty words, or stood in church and sang, My Jesus, I love thee, when I didn't mean it. A sense of defeat washed over me when it was shown how easily I had violated the fourth and fifth commandment, keep the Sabbath and honor my parents. The sixth witness stepped into the box. When he accused me of breaking the commandment, thou shalt not kill, I stepped forward to defend myself, only to be interrupted. If a man hateth his brother, he is a murderer. The prosecutor's voice hardened. Hate? Those angry storms in the soul, those outbursts of fury, those slow smoldering coals of bitterness that seek revenge or gloat over the ill fortunes of another? Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. I could feel the gavel descend before I heard, guilty. The seventh witness was sworn in. Anthony Jacob Lopez has broken the commandments. Thou shalt not commit adultery. I looked around in embarrassment and lowered my voice. Your Honor, I have never been immoral. Please, sir, I'm a married man. I'm a deacon. If a man looks upon a woman to lust after her, he hath committed adultery with her in his heart. Stepping closer to the judge, I pleaded, Sir, on March 6th, 2000, I jumped toward the prosecutor. No, no! Guilty. The judge spoke quietly, sadly, but his voice echoed harshly throughout the silent gallery. On and on it went. Thou shalt not steal. My head ached and my voice came out in a whimper. But I don't steal. The prosecutor chuckled in sarcasm. No? And what about the life that belongs to God? The tenth? The day? What about the honor that belongs to his son? Guilty. Weeping, I bowed my head. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not lie. Everyone waited for my defense, but hadn't the last hour just proved that I lied? Guilty. Finally, the last witness came forward. Thou shalt not covet. Guilty. And so we are simply proving what it says in the scriptures. If a man has violated one of the commandments, he has violated them all. Broken, I pleaded, please, sir, is it too late?
Do you think I could have counsel? My bloodshot eyes scanned the crowd of mocking faces, looking for someone, anyone who could help. From midway back, a simply dressed man came forward. Who are you?
My name is Mercy.
Oh, Mercy, is there anyone who could help? Laying a hand in my arm, and with tears in his eyes, Mercy asked, why don't you call for Jesus? Jesus, why didn't I think of that? A stern voice reminded me that there wasn't much time.
Anthony Jacob Lopez, have you anything to say for yourself?
I call for Jesus! At the sound of his name, the jury stood. The angelic guards made a path for him to pass through. The prosecutor put down his writ, and the judge nodded. Then, from the back of the room, I saw him coming. He had wounded hands and a thorn-crowned brow. I fell at his feet and cried, oh, Jesus, can you save me? Please, forgive me. Putting his arms around me, he lifted me and carried me to the judge.
Father, Anthony Jacob Lopez has called on my name. I plead the merits of my blood for his sinful soul and ask that you forgive, pardon, and give him a new life. At that moment, the whole assembly broke into singing. My shame fell away and my life became new. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Thank you so much, Anthony. Can you relate to Anthony at that judgment bar? Absolutely. Every one of us are guilty. And if you think you can get to heaven by being good, you are mistaken. There's only one way to heaven, and it is not knowing about Christ. It's not coming to church. It's not getting baptized. It is knowing Christ. It is calling to him to be filled and receive his love. You can receive him today. So dwell with him, have him dwell in you. And secondly is to be rooted in love. The second verb is describing how love comes to us as rooted. Paul is now going to turn to the world of the biologist and the world of the builder to describe God's love. Both a seed grows and a building grows, but they both grow in different directions. A plant will not grow unless it is planted in good soil. And that's why you desperately need a good church. If you don't go to a church that is rooted in the Word of God, if you go to the wrong kind of church, your spiritual roots will wither up, and so will your love for Christ, so will your love for others. Grounded in love, verse 17. Every builder knows that without a solid foundation, the building will crack and eventually fall when the storm comes. Jesus taught us, and we teach it to the kids with a song. The wise man built his house upon a rock. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. And when the storms of life come, the house on the rock stood firm, but the house on the sand fell. Matthew 7. Notice verse 18, that we may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, length, depth, and height, and to know the love of Christ. How great is his love? Usually we think of three dimensions, but here four dimensions are given. So breadth is the width, and so going in that direction, or the length in that direction, or the depth in that direction, or the height in that direction, no matter what direction you go, the love of Christ is unlimited. And so when the love of Christ dwells in your heart, and when the love of Christ is your root, and when the love of Christ is your foundation, now listen, that love for your children, and that love for your church, and that love for your spouse, it won't die. It won't die. If it's the love of Christ, it can't die. And you can keep loving your brothers and sisters in Christ, and you can keep loving your God, and you can keep loving your family. And if it dies, you got the wrong love. And so you pray to be filled with God's love. Lord, I ask you to fill me with your love. My love's not enough. One more prayer. Lord, I ask you to fill me with you, verse 19, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. What does that mean? To experience his fullness. Four times here in Ephesians, Paul says, God wants to fill us. Look over a page to chapter 5, verse 18. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Spirit filling means total dominance. When someone is filled with rage, they are dominated by hatred. When someone is filled with despair, they are dominated with hopelessness. When someone is filled with happiness, they're dominated with joy. Well, when someone is filled with God, what are they dominated by? Well, we're told, verse 19, spiritual songs about God, his word, and his truth. Verse 20, they're dominated with gratitude. They constantly thank God. They constantly thank others. They're dominated with submission, verse 21, to all the authorities in their life. They're dominated by godly family relationships, verse 22, and beyond. Thursday night, just 3 days ago, a ninth grader named Julia took her life because of cyberbullying by a classmate from Springford High School. One of her friends, who is in our church, asked me to ask you to pray for her family. The one who bullied her was filled with pride, filled with anger, filled with hate. But today, they should be filled with regret and sorrow and embarrassment. Their sin has now been made public to many. As for Julia, she claimed to know the Lord, but she lost all hope. You know what she needed? She needed this passage. She needed this message. How we need to share God's message of hope and love with others now. Lord, I ask you to fill me with you, to know you, to be dominated by you, to fellowship with you, to share you with others. And if you want to be filled with God, think of what he's like. We call that his characteristics. And so I want you, right now, I want you to think of his power, his majesty, his wisdom, his love, his mercy, his grace, his kindness, his patience. Three prayers. Lord, I ask you to fill me with your strength. I ask you to fill me with your love. I ask you to fill me with you. It's not about the body. It's about the soul. Then Paul closes this prayer with a benediction or praise. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. When the Holy Spirit has empowered us, when Christ indwells us, when his love dominates us, when God himself fills us, then he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think. Now, if you're not praying and you're not believing, you're not obeying, then you handcuff God's work in your life. But when you are praying and you are believing and you are obeying, then God's work is unlimited. Let me show you a picture. Do you know what this is a picture of? Please close your eyes. My message is almost done, but please close your eyes. Everyone has their eyes closed. And I want you to imagine where you are seated. There is not one thing on this property but one scrub tree. That's all. You just saw it. Eyes closed. Now listen to Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Do you want to see this verse? Please open your eyes. This is Ephesians 3:20. This is amazing. 14 acres, 4 buildings, beautiful landscaping. But honestly, it's not the buildings that I'm talking about. It's God's people in the building. And we are here to worship the Lord Jesus Christ and point people to him. And verse 21 says, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus. We're here today to give glory to God, glory to Jesus Christ. We're drawn because it's a Sunday. It's the first day of the week. We're celebrating. Jesus is alive. Jesus arose from the dead. Glory to God. And you are drawn not by my preaching and not by the music and not because of tradition. You're drawn by the power of the Spirit to gather together in a public place to become the temple of God. Remember last week, that is a testimony even to the angels, because we have been transformed, redeemed, saved, born again. Unto him be glory in the church. You can't keep me away. Can't keep me away. I'm drawn by his Spirit and his word to be with you, to praise Jesus Christ throughout all ages. Amen. That is Ephesians 3:20 and 21. This is one of the two purposes of our church, to give glory to God. The other purpose is to fulfill the Great Commission. Are you on board with God's plan, with God's program, with God's work, or are you just wasting another day of your life? May we pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the power of the Word of God. And we do pray that you would fill us with your strength. You would fill us with your love. You would fill us with yourself. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Do you know Jesus as your Savior? If you do, would you simply raise your hand? I am born again. You may put your hands down. You'd say, Pastor, I'm like Anthony in that courtroom. I know all about him. I think I'm good enough to get to heaven. At least I used to think that, but now I don't. I want to be saved today. Anyone at all, I'd like to receive Christ as my Savior. Would you raise your hand? Anyone at all, I want to be born again today. I want to receive Christ as my Savior. Christian, oh, would you pray that God would fill you with his strength, his love, himself. And when we as your vessels are cracked and wounded, may the light shine through those cracks. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let's stand together as we sing a song of invitation this morning, 534. Cleanse me as we sing, search me, O God, know my heart today. God wants to fill you, but he wants you to invite him to be at home in your heart as we sing on the first verse.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray.
So much, you can be seated. You pray for Anthony. He's going to do that again in the second hour today, and we want the power of God to be able to come through the message that he shared with us. Just some things to be able to share with you. Our ushers are going to come at this time with our faith, promise, commitment cards. This is for teenagers as well who have jobs. If you want to take this and just put it in your Bible for 2 weeks, and we'll collect them the week of Mission Conference, which ends 2 weeks from today, Easter next week, and then Mission Conference ends the following week. And then I want to show you our conference missionaries. We'll just go through here real quickly. We have the Ivies, be preaching Wednesday, Thursday, serving there. Uganda, Brother Stentis, be Saturday and Sunday. And the Brayson's, looking forward to him, preaching Friday night. And then we have Joel and Holly Buckingham going to Canada. And Thomas and Keisha Bowie, they're going to Indonesia. Esteban Alejandra Marquez to Mexico. And then Nate and Corey Mortensen going to Honduras. And so we want to welcome these folks. Be sure to get the picture of them, put it in your Bible, learn their names and faces. A wedded bliss double table shower for Emily Davis and Renee Bodie, and we want to be able to be a blessing to them. We did our community connections, and there's some great articles in here. If you would, if you are live outside the area where we blitzed and where we mailed, and that would be areas like Pottstown, South Phoenixville, Schwenksville, Gilbertsville. If you want to take 10 or 20, we have about 200 left. If you would take 10 or 20 that you could do your neighborhood, you can pick those up in the outreach center and be able to do that this week if you're able to be a part of that. And then our youth spring soccer begins. There's an envelope for those who want to have their kids do that, ages 4-year-olds to 5th grade. Pick up the soccer envelope. They get a t-shirt with that. See Randy Costin if you have questions about that. Connections. Get to know more about us. If you're new to the church, want to learn, meet the pastors, learn more about us, fill this out after the second service on April 30. And then Master Club. This is the picture I've been wanting to show you. Our kids had a great time. It's sporting events, it's spiritual events, teaching, preaching, missionary stories, and we wanted you to know about that. You want your kids in Master Club or your grandkids on Wednesday nights to be a part of that. Hospitality night is tonight. Every fourth month is hospitality night. Encourage you to invite others either to your home or out. We're inviting all the singles from the Singles ABF to our home. And then testimonies tonight. We postponed the testimonies from the Lord's Supper. That'll be tonight. Got a couple special testimonies. God working upon our church family to want to go out into the harvest field. You want to be out to be a part of that this evening. Well, let's all stand together, and we'll be dismissed in a word of prayer. Over the moat, the drawbridge to the king is our theme for Vacation Bible School. Be thinking now of children you can invite or even bring out. You can sign up to be a part of that. Last chance to get our Easter cards out. They're here and there in the foyer. Be sure to pick those up. Take them with you wherever you go. I have found in this last week when I use the word Easter as I pass a track out, man, there's a willingness. So many people don't have a church. Or if they have a church, they haven't been in 3 months. They can't remember the name of the church if it's been 3 years. And they're so glad to be able to take the invitation. And so be sure to be involved as a part of that. Brother Schneider is going to come at this time and lead us in a word of closing prayer.
Again, Father, we're so thankful for the word of God this morning. It is profitable for us. Most of all, Lord, we had the opportunity to hear it and have your word open up our eyes and our hearts to the gospel. We can come to you and know you as our personal Savior. Lord, we pray that you continue to use your word in our lives. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that we have. Lord, we're looking forward to a wonderful week next week with Easter. Lord, we have hope because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you watch over all that we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen.